BioBalance HealthCast episode 212, How Humans Learn and Adapt.
BioBalance HealthCast features conversations about positive aging. Your hosts are Dr. Kathy Maupin, Medical Director of BioBalance Health and a leading expert in treating symptoms of aging, and Brett Newcomb, a licensed professional counselor.
Welcome to the BioBalance HealthCast. This week, Dr. Maupin and I are going to be talking about a new medical research book that's out. But what's fascinating for me about it, the reason that I wanted to introduce the agenda today, is I've always been interested in the concept of perspective for learning and understanding. Some of you may know that many years ago, Archimedes said, if you give me a place to stand in a fulcrum, I can literally move the earth. If we can find a place to stand where we can move the earth, where we can see the things that we need to see, that would be supremely beneficial.
We could change things.
We can change things.
And that's what this book is about.
The challenge for learning, for education, for knowledge growth, for changes in techniques and technology is all about finding a place to stand where you can see the pieces and make them fit together. In my training as a therapist, as a psychologist, we studied, as an educator, we studied Piagetian theory. Jean Piaget developed a theory of cognitive processing and learning, and he talked about the fact that our brains, when we are born, our brains come with some hardwired systems, one of which he posits is language learning ability, that the ability to learn a language is a hardwired system that's built into the brain when you're born. But then through the process of experience, having stimulation, hearing language, hearing the rhythm of language, and so on, we assimilate that into our brain and adapt it into learning our own language. And so Piaget says, and others like him, that by the time a kid starts school, starts kindergarten, he or she has already learned the single most difficult academic lesson that they're ever going to need to learn, and learned it without teachers and without the structure of school, and that is that they have learned the rhythm and capacity of language, their language, whatever it is. And educators know that little kids learn other languages more readily, more easily, more quickly when they're little. The older you get, the more some of those pieces atrophy and fall off, and you can't even hear the sounds anymore.
The basis of human physiology or biology is that we adapt.
So
we have to have a basic gift of our genetics and of our birth that is hardwired. And that's true. They've never disproven the hardwired and the adaptation of the human body. But in this book, we're talking about this is Dr. Bland's book. And I kept reading this book on an airplane. My husband's going, "What are you oohing and aahing?" And I'm going, "That's why it works." Because he gets down with the microscope, basically. We're looking at microscopic ways the body works, the physiology, the chemistry of the body, and why when we give a medicine or we don't give a medicine or when we get sick, how that actually hones down to the cellular process. So that's what we're going to talk about today, because these are questions my patients ask me.
Right.
And I have time enough to go over their physiology and the bigger picture, but in an hour visit, I don't have time to go down to the cellular level. So that's what we're going to talk about today to help my patients understand that and everybody else who's interested in why the human body works the way it does.
So we're going to talk about balance and adaptation. The concept is that living organisms require or seek homeostasis,
which
is equilibrium or balance. And so whenever they get out of balance, there are mechanisms within the organism that operate then to restore the balance. Mm-hmm. An example of Jim Brady, who was Ronald Reagan's press secretary, was shot in the head. Part of what happened in his injury is that he lost his proprioceptors. Those are the automatic mechanisms in the brain that make you find a horizon and make you be able to stabilize your horizon so that you can stand upright and walk.
And so that you're not nauseated all the time.
And so one of his therapeutic adaptations over time was to learn cognitively to do something that happens unconsciously for the rest of us, and that is to find a horizon and a marker and track it so that he could stay upright and not just fall off as he started to walk. You can do that if you close your eyes and stand on one foot and then try to bring your fingertips together. You can feel the automatic adjustment of your musculature to keep you upright that happens through the operation of proprioceptors. But if you lose those, you don't have that, so you'll fall over.
So the human body
right.
has many different ways. In fact, we were talking about a movie. We were talking about Apollo.
Oh, Apollo 13.
13, and how
The Apollo program.
Apollo program has many had
was completely redundant.
Redundant. It many different redundant systems.
Multiple redundancies for every single ingredient, but one in the entire mission.
Not because they didn't want to do it.
The only part of the mission that didn't have a redundant capacity was the motor that fired to separate the lunar module from the lander, so that the lunar module could come back up to the command ship. Everything else had a backup system. And the example that we use is Apollo 13, when the command module blew out and lost most of its electricity and oxygen, what they had left was the lunar module, and they were able to use it to power up and fly that thing around the moon and back to Earth orbit. So they got home safely.
So that's why I always say God's body that he gave us, has all of these different, I mean, you can lose one part, or you can have a part of your body that's ill, and you develop another system to actually give you balance.
Right.
So that's
an adaptive process.
Basically what happens on, as you were describing, on the macrocosm, like
right.
getting your balance by looking at the horizon and getting a new neuro system so that you can be balanced. But it also happens that if you take a drug or you have an injury, your body develops some way of compensating for that. And it has many different systems for compensation. So we are trying to address what are the different systems and the
right.
mechanisms of how our body does that, knowing that we have many ways to fix ourselves and many ways that medicine uses to help fix us.
We'll give you another simple example of sensory adaptation. If you take a two pans of water, one ice cold and one warm, not mm-hmm. quite boiling, and you put your hands in those two pans mm-hmm. of water, you have four sensors in the surface of your skin, mm-hmm. hot, cold, touch, and pain. And they are set to a base level. Mm-hmm. If you immerse them in higher or lower temperature environments, they will reset their zero. Mm-hmm. So that if you then switch hands after they've reset, mm-hmm. you get different ranges of response. So your sensory mechanism will adapt to a new zero. And where this fits in the article that the chapter we're going to talk about in the book, the sensory adaptation, is that the communication process in your body is chemical and electronic. The electrical system fires
your nervous
the
system.
Nervous system, and the chemical systems of cellular communications have zero base. This is normal. This is homeostasis. This is where it needs to be.
We're talking about hormones and neurotransmitters.
Right. So if something begins to go wrong and your system begins to get out of homeostasis, then it tries to adjust and adapt. Mm-hmm. And it sends chemical signals to those cells that are having difficulty and says, hey, wake up, do this, do that. And sometimes the passageways are blocked. There's mm-hmm. too much going on. There's too much stress in your life.
Okay, for example,
all right.
you're stressed. We were not meant to have stress every day, all day long. We were not to have meant, our bodies weren't made for chronic stress, which we have now. But in the caveman days, we had the lion chasing us, that stress, and then nothing.
Right.
And then we could calm our system down. We were made for that kind of stress, not daily stress. So what happens is your brain feels stress, because mm-hmm. that's where it really is. Your brain's stressed. It sends a message to your pituitary gland, which is behind your eyes, and it says, we're stressed. Sends a message to your adrenal. Your adrenal makes cortisol. Your cortisol goes up, but it never can go back down. So you have more stress. So it sends more messages.
Because the cell that turns it off isn't reachable. It's blocked.
Yeah, it's blocked, but it's also, you keep sending that, I'm stressed, I'm stressed, I'm stressed.
Right, right.
So you're yelling, your brain's yelling at your pituitary gland, and your pituitary gland keeps going and trying to adapt
right.
until your cortisol is off the charts, and eventually your adrenal gland will just fail. You will have
what
chronic
adrenal fatigue.
Adrenal fatigue, excuse me. So adrenal fatigue where you have a very low cortisol and you can't mount a stress response.
Right.
So basically your body's screaming at your pituitary and it can't function anymore.
For instance, people that have significant trauma histories or trauma mm-hmm. environments, they reset their pain threshold
mm-hmm.
to an almost intolerable level for most people.
Mm-hmm.
And then their body is not recognizing or absorbing pain signals. And sometimes it makes them not get a warning that they need, like that they're having a heart attack or that there's something wrong with their system. A friend of mine recently died from a perforated bowel mm-hmm. because her abdominal pain was significant, as it would be if you were having that problem,
mm-hmm.
but she didn't register the pain signals.
Mm-hmm.
And so she didn't register the pain signals because of her trauma history and her sensory adaptation had reset the tolerance
mm-hmm.
too high. And her bowels ruptured and the infection got in her system and it killed her.
And that's a great example of not feeling the same amount. Some people feel pain more than others.
Right.
And people who've had a lot of pain, oftentimes either they're resistant to feeling pain or they are very sensitive to it. Usually the sensitivity comes before they're resistant. And so that's just so much outflow of the neurotransmitters that they reset. You
pain,
can't reset forever, though.
Pain and bacteria and germs are good things.
Right.
You know, the mutts always survive. It's the highly refined and segregated dogs overbred that die from the least little thing that happens.
But it's all good for you if you have, we always say moderation's is the goal.
Benjamin Franklin said moderation in all things except moderation.
Yeah, well, Benjamin Franklin's not the best example of this. Let's not use him as an example because he was not exactly
life,
the modern
the Hellfire
type.
Club, yeah.
So basically, but moderation in life, meaning run, but you don't necessarily have to run marathons because other things are going to be
right.
damaged if you do eventually, knees or
oh, you
stress
see these
receptors
people out running
or,
that are so addicted to running and they're withered and they're wizened and they can't stand up straight and they're kind of waddling down the road trying to run.
And they've hurt their knees and their hips and they've had to have replacements because of it.
Right.
So they wouldn't have to do that if they were moderate in their running, but many of them are not. So we're human, so we don't tend to be moderate people, but that's basically how we stay balanced. So that's how our bodies stay balanced. So now we need to address. So we know that that's one of the things our body adjusts for us. We don't even think about it. We're going about our daily life. And our body system is just figuring out how to make us live healthy lives. And it can do that to a point. But then we have too much of something like stress or too much of inflammation. Let's talk about inflammation because
right.
that's one of the things people will understand. Inflammation is something that if you have...
Talk about acute versus chronic.
Right, an inflamed knee. Say you have an inflamed knee.
Which
usually
is acute.
Acute. That would be it can be chronic though, but if you have an inflamed knee
mm-hmm.
and you've used it too much, so you sit down, you put your knee up, you put ice on it, you do what you're supposed to do, then your inflammation will be limited and it will go down. Or you take anti-inflammatories for a short period of time. So that's okay. Your body can adjust to that. But if you keep walking on it, or for instance, my husband had stem cell put into his knee,
yeah.
Well, that gives you an inflammatory process. It's supposed to.
Right.
So he had inflamed knee for 6 weeks, and all of a sudden he started getting kind of an irregular heart rhythm. Well, inflammation is not local. Even though your knee's the inflammation, it goes throughout your body. So that means you're getting inflammation in your heart. When you become chronic, it goes everywhere. And so that's not good for your body. And that is something that... I gave him a short course of anti-inflammatories so that we could just drop the inflammation throughout his body so that his heart would respond normally.
So there are things that physicians know to do to those acute situations.
Mm-hmm.
And you knew that that was an acute situation. Mm-hmm. You knew what was causing it. You knew what to do to treat it. But for a permanent condition or an overall condition where people don't necessarily know those things, they reset their zero, they do that adaptation thing, they learn to live with that level of pain and function as normally as possible, and then all of a sudden the system crashes. They have a stroke or a heart attack.
Well, they take anti-inflammatory medications all the time. So if you're chronically on anti-inflammatory medications and you're shutting down all of your inflammatory responses that are important for you, you need to know if something's really inflamed. But if you take an anti-inflammatory every day, then you don't get the pain, you don't get the signal that something's wrong somewhere. And that's what resets you.
So that's called an NSAID.
NSAID.
NSAID. Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug.
Right.
Like ibuprofen, aspirin, Aleve.
All those over-the-counter things.
Over-the-counter things that they advertise on TV, like, hey, just pop some of these, 6-8 a day, 2-4 a day, every day for the rest of your life. That's not a good response.
That resets everything, and then you can get sick in many other ways.
Right.
Although, we don't want inflammation throughout your body all the time is bad for you, too.
Right.
The point is, you should find the reason for the inflammation, treat that, and not just throw some NSAIDs at it, and then that gives you a different problem.
So what Dr. Brand is talking about in his book is how New Age medicine, frontier, leading edge medicine, is beginning to change its modality of understanding and approach from the classic symptomological response. Okay, your ear hurts, let's figure out what's causing your ear to hurt and let's find a treatment for it, to a systemic approach. Let's understand all of the interactive processes. So let's look at the cellular communication. Let's look at the electrical nervous system communication. But beyond that then, let's look at your genetic history. You know, if you're from a particular part of the world, you may be susceptible to certain things or have strengths or disadvantages if you are moved to a different part of the world. That
people
in that locale don't have.
We're like all far away from our genetics.
We live in an iodine sink.
Right. An iodine, zero iodine area.
Right. So we don't have iodine in our food.
Or water.
Somebody that lives in an area that has that isn't going to be susceptible to the same health issues that we're going to have because we don't have iodine.
We're going to have hypothyroidism and goiters.
Right.
Without iodine. Unless
we compensate for that with a medicine to offset the lack of iodine.
Or replace it.
Mm-hmm. So we look at the specific treatment of that. That's the classic way that medicine has approached it. Now Dr. Brand is saying medicine needs to step back, find like Archimedes, find a place to stand so they can move the world.
Mm-hmm.
And they do that on a multimodal or an integrated process that looks at the chemical communication systems of the body, how the cells talk to each other, switches turn on, turn off, what makes that work, what's the sequence. Like you were explaining about the stress signal going to the pituitary, going to the adrenal, going to the specific cells.
Right.
We need to talk about your genetics. We need to talk about your diet. There's fascinating stuff about food in this article. And the particular example that I appreciated was what they call the cod liver oil. They were recommending 2 to 5 grams of cod liver oil every day, but only if the cod liver oil comes from fish from Alaska or
the
Pacific Ocean, because the Atlantic is toxic. So the cod liver oil from Atlantic fish is subsequently going to contain those
toxins.
Needless
to say, this is complicated.
It is complicated.
And you find little pieces of information that you can put together to your best use for you, or you can bring this up to your physician. But one of the things that they talk about, I'll give an example. They talk about when you have so many things going wrong in your body,
right. Okay?
Just, we live in a world where we have, where our knees hurt, our stress level's high, our mother-in-law lives with us, we are not exercising and not eating right, and because we don't feel good, we eat more sugar, and all of those things are increasing what he calls the allostatic load.
Right.
It's just like screaming at your body. So your body has no way to balance.
It's like when a three-year-old is trying to get his mother's attention, and he just keeps going, Mom, Mom, Mom,
right.
Mom. And Mom ignores him.
On all these different levels.
Right.
And so your body just starts to, when you have all of that going on, you actually have to do a couple things. One is revisit your life and decide how you want to live. And if you want this to be make you sick, because you're going to be sick
like
if you
I
do that.
Like, I am genetically salt sensitive. My doctor said, give up salt. Quit putting salt on anything. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's enough in the processed food that you buy. There's mm-hmm. enough in the cooked food that you cook. Stop adding salt there.
And you know,
I mean, I used to salt watermelon.
You know, I'm not
anymore.
Speaking to that.
Yeah,
there's a lot of people that do that, but that's but if you are sensitive to salt, that's probably a really bad idea.
Right.
So basically, you have to look at everything in your life, your food, your response to stress. Do you just sit down and eat ice cream, which is not good for you
when you're
stressed?
Actually,
because that makes everything worse. Yeah, I knew that. So you do have to look at your lifestyle. Then you have to look at aging, because aging takes some things away from us that then imbalances us, and then we respond by doing bad stuff, like eating the wrong things because we feel bad. Like eating sugar, eating lots of sugar.
My 88-year-old aunt says it's really hard for her. She's losing weight, and the doctors are fussing at her, and they've got her on those protein supplement drinks and stuff. And she says it's really hard for me because the only thing I can taste anymore is sweet. So the only thing I want to eat is sweet.
Oh, that's not
And she says, I have to consciously and deliberately make myself eat other things.
That's when you're really old.
Yeah.
And you have no hormones.
She's 80.
And everything, your body is dwindling.
She's still mean as a snake.
Yeah, well. But. Yeah, she still has enough energy for that. That usually is the last to go. But I'm kind of thinking about the middle age, 40 to 50 or 55, where all of a sudden we become off balance because we've lost our testosterone, or we've lost our progesterone, or we've lost our estrogen, and we go through menopause. So each one of those things makes us be imbalanced. And one of the things testosterone does is keep you from having insulin resistance or sensitivity to sugar. So basically, we become much more sensitive to sugar because our testosterone is gone. And that makes us much more likely to have diabetes.
Which is an epidemic now.
Which is an epidemic, and much more likely to have Alzheimer's. So it's a slippery slope. So what do? You replace what's missing.
Right.
You replace what happened. Well, stress happened, but did that happen first or second? Well, doesn't matter. We need to replace the testosterone that's missing, or replace any hormone, thyroid, any hormone that's missing, back to young, healthy levels, because that balances us.
Right.
Then we need to look at, is your cortisol still up?
Right.
If that's still up and you're still stressed, you need to look at your life. But I usually give people 6 to 12 months of a glandular, a very small amount of animal adrenal, which then helps them reset their pituitary and their adrenal so that they don't make so much cortisol. So that gives them some rest from this feeling like I'm going to climb out of my skin. So that helps them. So you need somebody to help you look at that. Then you will feel good enough, well enough, to say, let's look at my diet. Let's look at the other things I can change, because then you have enough energy. Get your hormones back. That's kind of the first step. Then you decrease your cortisol level to normal. Then you have enough energy to actually exercise and eat right and do the things you're supposed to do.
So you reset the hormones because they are the primary cellular messengers.
Right.
That
they go
take
to every
the messages
cell.
To the cell to say, do this, don't do that. When the system, because of the background noise of the stress and the chronic inflammation, overloads so that those cells are not responding to those hormones, mm-hmm. then you have a chronic illness, a heart attack, a stroke, mm-hmm. some major thing go wrong. Mm-hmm. They then have to fix that major thing.
Mm-hmm.
And when that major thing is adjusted, then they pull back and say, now let's look at the overall system.
Right.
How do we tune this engine
But
up?
Oftentimes I have patients that come in and have major illnesses. They have autoimmune disorders like rheumatoid arthritis, or they have a thyroid autoimmune disorder like Hashimoto's, and they come in and of course they're already being treated for these things,
right.
but they're not better. So why are they not better?
Right.
Well, part of it is they don't have what they need to balance themselves. The medicine's just helping the symptoms or stopping the progression of the disease.
Right.
So they need to actually restore themselves.
So they can't get back to homeostasis.
They can't do it without their hormones. So they need to have their hormones back, but it is a stepwise process.
Right.
It's kind of like building blocks. So we're kind of building everything up, starting with the basis of what's the first thing that happened? Well, probably stress. I can't fix your life immediately, but I can give you enough energy so you can fix it. So when we give the hormones back, that's a first step in balance.
Well, and one last point that to make about the chapters that we were reading that we were talking about today about cellular communications is Dr. Brand talks about biodiversity. Mm-hmm. Our bodies are diverse ecosystems. In a diverse ecosystem, if something goes wrong and breaks or dies, the rest of the ecosystem still lives and functions. Like you can lose your eyesight, but you can still live and function and mm-hmm. be in balance and have a productive and useful life. In a non-diverse system, like a cornfield as opposed to a mm-hmm. tropical jungle, mm-hmm. if the corn crop dies, the whole thing's over. Mm-hmm. So he is saying it's a good thing that we are diverse mm-hmm. and that we can fix or adjust these things. Maybe not every piece of it to restore you to full health, mm-hmm. but we're looking at the balance. It's like the children's game Jenga, which mm-hmm. is that column of wooden blocks that you pull things off of and pull things off of and pull things off of until it collapses. Mm-hmm. And what he's saying is that medicine is now trying to be able to insert those blocks back in the system so that you don't collapse.
Let me say one thing about diversity. Diversity yes. does not mean our body's goal is to live, but right. that doesn't mean it lives well.
Right.
So many times in diversity, the primary path is the healthiest and what makes us feel healthy and what look healthy and be healthy. But then the secondary path that's been built in for us keeps us alive, but doesn't necessarily keep us healthy. And there are other imbalances that can happen. That's why disease happens. Otherwise, if every path was equally good,
right.
we'd never get sick.
Right.
Because we would always be balanced. But each path, the path that's not primary always has a cost. So that's why it takes physicians to look at that first path and try to get you back on that path so that you cannot be sick. And one of the things, like, you're insulin resistant, and then your response to that is you become obese.
Right.
Okay? So insulin resistance is not a normal thing for humans. We're not supposed to be insulin resistant. That makes us gain fat, lose muscle, not have energy.
Right.
So our primary path was good homeostasis between blood sugar and activity, and actually with all of our hormones intact, we were not insulin resistant. But when one Jenga thing comes out, then our body goes to another path to
right.
survive.
Right.
And that is illness. And so we do have to find and hopefully doctors will embrace this a little bit more, find a pathway back to health instead of just a pathway back to, let's get rid of that symptom, because usually that has a cost or a price.
So they have to find a place to stand where they can see more.
Which is where I stand, and I love to stand there.
Which is the whole thing about perspective. You know, if you hold your thumb up, you can block out something. Mm-hmm. But the further away you get from it, the less you can block it out. You just block out part of it. So artists can, you can look at good art and see mm-hmm. the operation of perspective in that to be able to see what you can see. So this article and Dr. Maupin's practice are all built around the concept of having the systemic perspective to make your life healthy and qualitatively the best it can be.
I'm not just the hormone queen.
You're not just the hormone queen.
We balance everything. We do nutritional counseling. We do dietary counseling,
lifestyle,
exercise counseling, and
even
stress
beauty.
Counseling. And even
you look good,
we
you
even
feel
do.
Good.
Yeah. So that's what we do. And that's why we're here talking about it, because you should be interested in how to keep yourself healthy and balanced.
Thank you for listening.
Email your questions or comments to podcast@biobalancehealth.com. You can find the BioBalance HealthCast on iTunes and on YouTube. For more information about bioidentical hormone pellet therapy and other reverse aging solutions, visit biobalancehealth.com or call 314-993-0963. You can find Dr. Maupin on Twitter at Dr. Kathy Maupin and on Facebook at facebook.com/biobalancehealth. Find Brett Newcomb at brettnewcomb.com.